Welcome to this presentation from the Urban Penguin. My name is Andrew Mallett, and today we're going to take a look at load balancing within XenApp 6.5. As always, you can find these videos on theurbanpenguin.com, and you're able to follow me on Twitter at The Urban Penguin and on Facebook, The Urban Penguin. If you're into the Access Gateway, I do have a book that's available now on the Access Gateway 5. So one of the most important features of XenApp 6.5 is being able to load balance even in smaller farms. This is going to be a very useful feature. Load evaluators are most usually assigned to servers, and this is done through group policies in XenApp 6.5, but we'll see we can also assign load evaluators to applications. As standard, we are provided with both the default and the advanced load evaluator, and the default load evaluator is assigned to all servers if we haven't made any changes. The supplied load evaluators within the default load evaluator, we just look at the server user load, so the number of users connected to a server, and load throttling. This then adjusts how many users can connect during the login phase. And in the advanced, we're looking more at load, where we're looking at CPU utilization, memory utilization, page swap, and again the load throttling. Load throttling really artificially inflates a server load whilst a login process is actually happening to try and limit the number of concurrent logins that will be happening. Once the login has finished, then the load throttling is disregarded. These are not editable, so neither the basic or the advanced load evaluator can be edited, but we can copy them to create new custom load evaluators. Within custom load evaluators, we can create new load evaluators from scratch or copy existing ones, and we can also include rules that look at things like the client IP address to make sure that some servers are kept private, perhaps time schedules, disk input output, and even the number of users connected to particular applications. XenApp servers will always report their information back to their data collector, and new sessions then are connected to the server that is most capable of handling that sessions. However, though, existing sessions are never moved, and if a user has a session on a server, then so long as the application can be hosted on that server, they're always going to be connected back to that same server. Finally, with load balancing policies, we can further extend load balancing, especially if we have a couple of data centers. We can make sure that London users only connect to the London servers unless there are no London servers available. And we could say that the Manchester users always connect to the Manchester data center unless there are no Manchester servers available. So it can almost give you a little bit of failover and redundancy without users normally connecting to remote servers. We can also force streamed applications to always be streamed or always accessed on the server, dependent on maybe things like the client IP address. So we get into the video now and look at some of the demonstrations and see how load balancing goes together in XenApp 6.5. So if we start off going into App Center and expanding our XenApp and our farm node, if we move down then to our load evaluators, we can see we've got the advanced and the default load evaluator. So these are supplied as standard, and as I say, these are non-editable, but we can create new load evaluators from these load evaluators. If I click on the load evaluators node, and then if we move to usage by server, we can see that XenApp 1 and XenApp 2 both have the default load evaluator assigned to them. If we move to usage by application, we can see that currently there is no application that has a load evaluator assigned to it. Moving into the default load evaluator, we can see on the current settings tab that we're based on then the server user role, and we report a full load when 100 users are connected. And then load throttling, so this, as it says here, is the impact of logins on the load, and that's the high or default setting. If I move out to the command prompt, And from the command prompt, if I issue query farm and then / load, we can see that currently XenApp server 1 has a load of 100, XenApp server 2 has a load of 0. There's one connection I'm remoting into XenApp 2, but I'm not remoting into, I'm remoting into XenApp 1 at the moment, but I'm not remoting into XenApp 2. Hence, we see the difference in load. So I'm still on XenApp server 1 and I've just started up the web browser and I'm connecting in. And we can see that we've got the Notepad published application. So even though I'm actually running this from XenApp server 1, we know because the least loaded server is currently XenApp server 2, we're going to be directed to XenApp server 2. So if we fire up Notepad, whilst we're looking at the process, if we go through, we can see currently then during the log on process the load throttling load increases, so it's given me a total load of 5100. But then once the login process has completed, we can see then that the load now on both servers is 100. And the idea, as I said, with the load throttling is that we can see that if a server is least loaded and then we get a busload of people turn up at 9 o'clock in the morning, we don't want them all being directed at the same time to the one server. So to reduce the likelihood of that happening during the log on process, we then have the load throttling load. So whilst then we're logged on to Notepad, we've got the load of 100 now on both servers. If I exit the application, so I go File and Exit, I will keep the load on the server for just a little while. Remember, when we were looking at our group policies, one of the things we set in our group policy in Lesson 14 was to set the linger timeout. The idea of the linger timeout was if somebody logs out of an application, it keeps it running for a short amount of time to speed up their access to their next application. If I go into App Center and if we move through to the servers node, I can see that we've got a connection then, so the ICA connection, but it's lingering on XenApp server 2, and whatever I set the linger timeout to, maybe 15 minutes, we will keep the session active for 15 minutes, and of course then that shows as a user load on the server. But if I go through and now log this user off, with the user now logged off, when we go back and look at our query farm command, we can see we're back to just the load of 100 with one user connected via RDP to XenApp server 1 and no users connected. So we see we get a very simple process of just incrementing by 100 the load of the server each time a user connects. If you have an existing session on a server, you can connect to that session. Didn't work in this case because even though I was connected to the same user, one user had an RDP session, whereas when I was going in then through the web interface server, I was making an ICA connection to the application. So if we move across and take a look at the advanced load evaluator, again on the current settings tab, we can see that it looks at the CPU utilization, reporting low load at 10% utilization, a full load at 90%. We have the same load throttling rule, memory utilization again 10% for no load, a full load at 90%, and page swaps, no load at 0 swaps per second and a full load at 100 swaps per second. If we have multiple evaluators, so here really we've got the page swaps, the memory utilization and the CPU utilization, they all add together to give a combined total. So it's unlikely that any one of these rules would actually hit their upper level, because if my CPU utilization, let's say, is 85%, well, chances are my memory utilization is going to be over 10%. So in that case, probably I'm going to be hitting the 10,000 upper limit well before any of my rules hit their maximum. But at least this way, we are looking at an actual load of the server. If we wanted to create our own load evaluators, we can right click and then new, add load evaluator, give it a name, so we could say call this test or whatever. And then we can see the rules, so it could be based on how many users are connected to an application. Context switches per second, so this is how quickly how many times per second the CPU switches between tasks. CPU utilization, disk operations, IP address ranges, so this is ways of keeping servers just for people outside of the organization or only for people on the internal network. The load throttling rule that we've already seen, memory utilization, page faults and page swaps, scheduling, so you could put a schedule to make a server only available at certain times. But if I say it's only available from 9 to 5 during office hours, let's say, if somebody is connected to it 5 to 5, they will still remain connected to it at 5 o'clock and beyond, just not accepting new connections. And then, of course, the server user load that we've already seen. Just cancel out of this, we won't create it. If I want to assign a load evaluator to a server, then we do that through policies, either the Active Directory policies or the local IMA-based policies. So if I move through to my policies node here and jump onto the computer tab, if I wanted to apply to all servers, then we could go through and edit, go through to the settings, and we could search here. So we could go through and just put, say, load, add in then the load evaluator name, and then we can browse through and select, let's say, the advanced load evaluator, and then OK. Now the group policy will take effect on a server startup. If it's an IMA policy, it will also work on starting of the IMA service, and of course on a group policy refresh. So of course, if I go through and query the farm at the moment and look for the load, we can still see that we're reading the default load evaluator. But if I go through and run a GP update, and then we'll go back and query the farm load, we can see now that I've hit the load of 10,000 on this server. Pretty much, I don't have a lot of resource, so probably when I go through and start looking at it, my memory utilization is going to be pretty high anyway. I'm running these just with a gig of RAM. But it then just gives you an idea that we're going to see different settings based on then the actual performance of the server. If we wanted to go through then and remove this, this will set it back then to the defaults. Or if we go through and edit it, even force it back to the default, and then OK. Again, run my GP update, and now go through and look at the load. We can see we get back to the settings of the default load evaluator. So there's no real right way or wrong way of setting up your load management. Obviously, it has to match your servers. Obviously, the default that's provided by Citrix is a very vanilla system. So long as most of your servers then have the same hardware and users use the servers in the same way, the default load evaluator is going to be okay. but where we have different hardware or the usage of the application could vary quite differently across the different servers, certainly we're going to need to put in some metrics that do really show the load of the server. Most advice would take you down the track of assigning load evaluators to servers, but in special circumstances you may find your environment benefits most from assigning a load evaluator to an individual application. So I could go through to, let's say, my calculator application. From the right click and other tasks menu, we can then go through to attach application to load evaluator and then just choose the load evaluator that we want. So load evaluators can be assigned to applications, but in general assigning them to servers is probably going to be most effective. Through servers we always assign through group policies, but for applications we assign it through the properties of the application, or at least, as we see here, the other tasks. We also have load balance policies here, and when we go through and, let's say, look at my servers, we have servers in London and we have servers in Manchester. When I look at my worker groups, very often we will then have a worker group that represent our London servers and our Manchester servers. In my case, when we're setting up the worker groups, I just say, look, this is based on the farm servers, all those servers in the Active Directory, the AD servers. But when we go through and look at our load balancing policies, so if I choose load balancing policies and from the right click menu create a load balancing policy, and we could call this, let's say, London, and then we could specify for whom it should affect. So we could then choose the client IP address range. So we might know that our clients in London then are on the 192.168.0 network. So we apply this to this client address range, and then our worker group policy preference, we could then go through and say that they connect first of all, let's say, to the London servers and then the Manchester servers. I know this doesn't say London and Manchester, but you get the idea. So if we add them both in and then go OK, if the IP address range that we put in was for London, we would want them to access the London users first, so that would be a priority of one. So London users can access the London data center first. For the Manchester data center, and we're just assuming then that this reads Manchester, we decrease the priority. So what we're saying is that users who match the client IP address that we're saying would be London are allowed then to access the AD servers worker group first, and not until all of those servers are fully loaded do we move across into all servers. And remember, we say for the purpose of the demonstration, we were saying this could be the London worker group, this could be the Manchester worker group. So we don't fail over onto the Manchester worker group until all of the local servers are populated. We could do it for worker group preference to have our failover there, or we could do it on streamed application delivery. We could say, well, look, if you match this IP address range, you should have the offline plugin, so we will force applications that can be streamed through to your desktop. Or we might say, well, if you're on this IP address range or you're not on this IP address range, then you're remote and probably streaming won't work for you. So we could force then the applications to be streamed to the servers and then accessed as hosted applications. So worker group preference is trying to keep data center users close to their local data center and only failing over when all local servers report a full load. And then we could also use it for forcing or streamed application delivery or access to hosted applications. So thank you for your time, and I do hope you've enjoyed this presentation. Remember, the book is available online and you're able to follow me on social media.